I come in, fate's messenger.
In which he's talking about the signs of the end times. Well, one of the signs of the end times is what you're talking about right now, a period in history wherein true believers are going to be persecuted, true believers. And in fact, you know, we did this program, you and me and the Hagmans did this program a year ago, A Blood on the Altar, the coming war between Christian versus Christian. So it isn't just persecution of Christians by outsiders. It's one whole side of the modern-day denominationalism, and the Bible says about them that not only are we going to be beheaded for our witness of Jesus Christ, but the day is coming when those who deliver you up to be afflicted and kill you are going to think that they are in the service of God. And so it doesn't surprise me, Steve and Joe and Doug, that we're seeing this division now that's happening, where you have those who are saying, don't listen to those prophets of doom. Come over here and let's all sing Kumbaya, because this was the way it was at the time of Christ. It's the way it's prophesied to be at the end of time. It's actually a sign that we're entering into a period called the Great Tribulation Period, in which the man of sin is going to behead those who will not worship him. The beast, the false prophet, is going to cause the organized church to give power unto his image, to bow down before him. So that's exactly what's happening. I'm glad you opened the show by bringing that up, Steve. I don't ever tell people this is my best work ever, because if I'm working on a book project like this one right now, Unearthing the Lost World of the Cloud Eaters, the documentary film, if I'm doing it, it's because I'm into it. I had some rare opportunities that are outlined in that book, and we're not talking about that tonight, so I won't roll. Maybe we'll come back and do a different sure. show on it. But I had real opportunities. I mean, I went back to the house of the temple. We got beneath the surface, but I'm going back right after the conference, Steve. I'm going back to Washington, D.C. I'm going to be meeting with Lieutenant Colonel Robert McGinnis at the Pentagon, where I'm going to be introduced to some different people there. But there's a whole lot that's going to come out in this, and let's just say that it makes Pizzagate look like a 12-year-old birthday party. So, and maybe we'll talk about that too. But now let's talk about, how did I get started this whole unearthing the lost world of the cloud eaters? You have this groundbreaking book, first book ever by me and Steve Quayle together. That's one surprise to a lot of people, since we've been doing radio since the shortwave radio days. You know, everybody thinks that we've done a dozen books together. We haven't. This is actually the very first time. And then there's the documentary film from Gen 6 Productions, which is, again, setting the bar on how fine Christian filmmaking ought to be made. And then there's the conference, and the conference is almost sold out right now. I talked to the guy that's helping us with this here just a couple of days ago. It's Steve's conference. I'm just there, and I'm going to be part of it, and I'm going to speak. There's only a limit of just under 3,000 seats, and almost every one of them is sold already. It's going to be sold by the time we get there. So if people are listening to this program tonight and they want to be there in person, man, they need to run right now to the website.
Tom? Yeah. Hey, Tom, I need to interrupt you. There is no more space because we've got to abide by it, you know. So there are only positions, 370 left for live streaming.
Oh, I got you. So, I mean, there's only 370 yeah. left for live streaming. Wow. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Well, so people need to do that. So there's going to be right at 3,000 of us that are going to be at the what do they call the place where we're going?
The mansion.
Yeah, the Branson Mansion. Big, beautiful, yep. gorgeous performance theater. This is where the Oak Ridge Boys do like 25 concerts a year and a whole bunch of other really well-known group. So gigantic stage with all the lights. I'm just hoping Steve can use some of those lights to make me look pretty. big, huge place, and it's just packed to the walls then. Every seat in it is sold. And then people around the world are going to be watching the live stream. Well, if there's only 300 or whatever you just said left, they need to do that. You're going to be there, Steve. I'm going to be there. L.A. Marzulli is going to be there presenting. Of course, Timothy Alberino. Dr. Michael Lake is going to be there. You mentioned Pastor Langford earlier. Derek Gilbert, the host of Skywatch Television, is going to be there. And Film Piorambla. I mean, I'm really looking forward. You know, this guy is the legendary European adventurer. And he, I think he's going to be bringing, I've heard some stuff behind the scenes, maybe I shouldn't even mention it and not give it up, but he's going to be bringing some stuff on maybe the Vatican and some of his work there. But yeah, nothing like this before. And by the way, if you limit conferences in the United States just to prophecy-themed conferences, there's no other conference in the nation that even comes close to how well this has sold out, Steve. So kudos to you. It does show that in spite of the fact that you're being listed, you know, by some of these fake news, hate group, washed up, right-wing watch, whatever they're called, news agencies, that the majority of people out there that are attuned to the times are very much interested in and want to know. They want to know. They want to know the facts of what has happened, is happening, is coming, but also what can they do about it. If they want to be empowered to know what actions they can take. And, of course, I know that Pastor Langford and some of the Henry Groover will be able to also give them the biblical equipment to be able to deal with what is coming upon the earth so that they, too, will not have hearts failing them for fear, right?
Exactly. And I think, too, to everyone that's listening, this is a time of equipping of the saints. Tom and I and L.A. Marzulli and Anselm P. Rambla and Derek Gilbert, and Derek will be moderating our roundtable, Tom, between you and I and Tim. And, you know, we'll try and cover the most prescient information and the most commonly asked questions. But going through this whole, if you will, over and over in my head, I think this thing has been so orchestrated by the living God. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we could not have arranged in South America what came out. And those of you that were there with us on the True Legends expedition were blown away, too, because you watched very high-ranking, quote, Vatican officials lie to your faces and tell you that Father Gamara, by the way, Tom, was the guy that gave Anselm P. Rambla the permission to excavate in the Coricancha into the Shinkana, the underground tunnel system that basically everybody knew existed, but the official position of the church is there is no such thing. And why this is important is because Anselm, basically, and this guy's been all over the world, one of the most famous explorers in the world, and some of the most striking adventures the exposure of so much hidden archaeology and real archaeology. There was an attempt, even while we were there, they said that Father Gamara was not on the premises. And lo and behold, he literally shows up in the courtyard. We got him on film stating, you know, and he called Anselm P, like Pi is his middle initial and name. And he acknowledged and said on camera, yes, it's all true. Even while we got the guys in their multi-$1,000 suits, their mics, their headphones, people flipping out, you know, trying to deny it, trying to basically say, you can't film, you can't do this, you can't do that. And I love it. I called it God's sense of humor because they were telling us that we can't do this, we can't do that, and in walks the man that can validate it all. But what we're trying to do, ladies and gentlemen, is to bring you six different viewpoints of not overlapping investigation, but unique. And see, this is kind of like the temple that was built in the wilderness. Everything has been built separately, and now God himself is bringing the pieces of the puzzle together. And, you know, I've quoted Newton's statement that at the time of the end, God's going to raise up a group of men who are going to be given to prophecy, but it's going to be amongst much clamor and opposition. Tom, you quoted the scripture that there'll be coming a time when men will kill us, claiming they're doing God a favor. I already see the lines being drawn. I believe this charisma article, and I will answer that woman, is the first shot or salvo. If Jesus himself said, just as in the days of Noah, you've got to understand, we live in George Orwell's prophetic written world now, and he made the statement, they who control the past determine the future. I believe that by the time you've listened to Derek Gilbert talking about Inception, you've listened to Dr. Dr. Michael Lake. I'm just trying to keep the order in my head. He did the most marvelous job on Doug, your show last week. He was exquisite. So when you hear all these guys, L.A., Timothy Alberino, who's got this stuff dialed in like nobody's tomorrow, and plus he's half my age, Tom, the thing is that that's important because the young people have got to grow up in the things of God, turn off their video games, turn off the devil vision, and begin to seek the truth. To seek the truth of God's word. And, you know, I'm concerned, Doug, for the generation now that is right behind ours, I guess they'd almost be now our grandchildren's age coming up, is that the fact that they know not God. The hunger for things of God, it's dying out. The love of many is waxing cold. The salt has lost its savor. And, you know, you can go on wanting to make happy talk in Charisma Magazine, and that's even named magazine if they're taking that position, because the testimony of Jesus is a spirit of prophecy. If Jesus didn't think the days of Noah were important, and just as Tom listed Matthew 24, Luke 21, Mark 10 or 11, and all the prophecies of Daniel, all the prophecies of Isaiah, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, Amos, Haggai, Hosea, Zechariah. These are not in order, by the way. I'm just saying this. And the greatest prophet of all is Jesus. And when if people will not listen to that, and you know, I understand now where basically there has been a gospel ignorance that has resulted in the divorce from those who claim to know Jesus as Lord and Savior to not even believing that anymore, claiming Jesus is a metaphor of good, the devil's a metaphor of evil, and that Jesus just came along to help us live better lives. That's horse manure. Without the blood of Jesus, there is no redemption. So why is this situation in Branson so important? I can tell you this, that when men of God like Henry and David Langford are praying and fasting, calling on God to make and to move amongst the people of God, something's going to happen. And I mean that for a good state. We're going to give you the background. And, some people say, well, it's so scary. No, it's not scary. Your primary weapon in overcoming fear is knowing what is coming on the horizon. What do you think people go to fortune tellers and read chicken entrails or basically, do horoscopes or do all the things or, do human sacrifice? They want to know what the future holds. And so just as they who control the past determine the future, they're doing everything they can to try and get in to the space-time continuum and to change history. Well, I got news for you. The God of heaven allows them only to go so far. So when people tell you time is speeding up, it literally is speeding up because it's a biblical statement for the elect's sake. And, the idea simply is this. In Branson, you'll be presented with, I would say, six very, very determined and I would say highly researched efforts of everyone that has even been invited to that. And it's not that we think that we know everything or that nobody knows anything else, and I've had people suggest that because they're not invited. I say, look, this thing came together fast. This is who the Lord laid on my heart, and I've never met Dr. Michael Lake. I just recently met L.A. Marzulli in Peru. And obviously, I know Derek from his interviews, and I actually coined a term, Tom. I don't know if you know this, but I now have a new word. It's called Encyclopedia Gilbertica. Sounds like you know how to speak Spanish.
I know, right?
Yeah. And I mean, I don't think there's somebody that can do a better interview than Derek. That's not flattery. That's not, anything other than that. So the purpose of all of this at Branson, and then that for you to take it forth from that, is to get you trained. Because I'm telling you this, when what continues to happen, that's already happening in Houston, and if you haven't noticed, ladies and gentlemen, the entire red state area along the Gulf Coast, now going up the East Coast, isn't it interesting? It sure isn't hitting California, and it sure isn't hitting between the liberal, if you will, I call it hellhole states. What it's hitting is the red states. And so we're talking about gasoline. You know, Tom, I posted, an alert yesterday in my alert section and told everybody gas is going to dry up and then it's going to be food. People don't understand. Houston is not only one of the biggest ports in the United States, third largest city, but it feeds. It literally, and no pun on the word, but it provides food and all the goods, the entire East Coast going up into the central plains of the United States. So it's already in the land. The famine is coming. And if you think $8 to $10 a gas for gasoline, which is now being seen in Dallas, wait until you see $10 for a can of soup, you know, chunky bee soup, $10. You think that's so far-fetched? You watch it. You see, I've come to the point, and you know I've said this, Doug, you know I've said this, Tom, but people don't want to know the truth because, quote, it scares them. It's not that it scares them primarily. It's that it demands action on their part. How many people stayed in Houston seeing the horrific satellite pictures because they listened to the words of a man who, obvious now in retrospect, has lost all credibility, the mayor, and this is the same thing over and over and over. I posted another alert, and it's all based on prophecy by my friend, and she's a former DHS FEMA, you know, emergency management person, telling that they knew about this hurricane months ago, and the whole thing is the moving of entire populations out of areas into control zones. I know her. She is who she says she is. So how is this important to what we're talking about tonight? I know Tom Horn very well. We've spent a lot of time, a lot of years on talk radio. I think a room in their home is devoted to Steve. I've been out there so many times. And thank you and Nita for your lovely hospitality. But the point is that we're doing what God has called us to do. And Tom, you know, go ahead and share how you got into this. Because I think, you know, the Bible says, know them that labor amongst you. And I don't think people understand that, you know, the amount of background, blessing, movement, disappointments, discouragements, everything that God does to bring a person, a man or a woman, to the point where he can use them. And as you said, you thought you would retire. So share your story, because I think it's pretty amazing.
Well, and so one final thing, because you keep firing up my motor here. People need to know that, again, it's Bible prophecy that the day is coming when it says the Antichrist is going to be given power to make war against the saints and to overcome them. So that's the reason that we don't try to put, you know, sugar on every cake we serve, that if we are truly moving into a prophetic era of time, people like you and I would have said, get out of your houses, move now. How heartbreaking was it, Stephen? You recall this, by the way. When Fukushima first happened, all of us, you sell emergency supplies, I sell emergency supplies, and we were all sold out in one day. The rest of the year, you're sitting there, you've got all these supplies, the warehouses are full, people can get potassium iodide, they can get nuke detectors, they can get all this stuff, gas masks, they get long-term storage food, water purification systems, they can get all this stuff. It's just sitting there ready, right? It's not even all that expensive. But they just don't do it. And then all of a sudden you have a Fukushima, and we've got stuff that's coming that's going to put Fukushima to shame. Now everybody's clamoring, well, we sold out in one day. In one day we were out of everything, and we had backlogged orders for 6 months. In fact, we had to just start giving people's money back. We had to just start saying we can't take orders. Remember Mountain House Foods shut down their website? ThyroSafe Potassium Iodide shut down their website. They just said, sorry, folks, there's nothing. You're on your own. Well, that is why people should do what you said a moment ago, Steve. When they can, as they have the opportunity, to whatever extent they can, they ought to prepare, not just for, obviously, for the kind of terrible circumstances that we're seeing right now in Texas, but this other stuff, the coming of Antichrist, this is going to be a whole different new kind of level, and people need to be ready. So anyway, all right, I know we're not here to talk about that today. And the whole truth is, you know, how I got started really is, how did I get started on this subject matter? How did we wind up in the Four Corners area? You know, it seems like that's been a couple of years ago to me now, but it wasn't. It wasn't even a year ago. And here's me, you, Timothy Alberino, the whole Skywatch Television team, the Defender Publishing team, your group, you're flying in this big helicopter into the Valley of the Gods. How did we wind up in that place, and what were we doing there? Now, that's part of what this conference is going to be about, but it really goes to some much deeper questions, not just the bones of the giants. That's part of it. That's important. That's part of American history, and that also tells us a whole lot that dates back to the watchers who descended in the days of Jared, what they were doing, but also what Jesus says, as it was in the days of Noah. You quoted that a moment ago, what they intend to do in the future. But it isn't just them. It's their devotees. How many people realize that in Washington, D.C. today, there are people who are making concerted efforts to try to bring about the revival of the spirit of the watchers, the Nephilim, the king of the giants that the book of Revelation says is bound in the bottomless pit for the time being. This is stuff that puts Hollywood to shame. They can't make film. They can't make movies that are as exotic and frankly terrifying as what the future of the world is set to behold. And this is why people are going to be frozen in their tracks. And frankly, be susceptible to the lies of Antichrist and to the lies of the anti-church that are those ones that are going to cast their lot for the destruction of believers who otherwise are giving them the truth, and that's why they need to get the truth now. So now for me, how did I get started into all this? I'm not going to go into all this stuff about me and Chris Putnam, but if people listening to this program are not aware of how I got into this line of thought and then began to appreciate the importance of it, I'm speaking at the Strategic Perspectives Conference for our good friend Chuck Misler about 5 years ago now, probably. My son and I were standing in the back room, and we're talking about how weird it is that you have this 900-year-old Catholic prophecy, and no matter what you make of it, you believe it, you don't believe it, you think it was all a big hoax, it didn't matter. It had historical importance because it's a 900-year-old Catholic prophecy that certainly was held in high esteem by even some of the popes. And my son and I, Joe Artis, we're talking about that, and we're saying, isn't it weird that there's only 112 lines, and Pope number 111, Pope Benedict the 16th, is the Pope right now, but if he dies or if he steps aside, the very next guy is going to be the final one in this prophecy, and nobody has written a thorough examination of this prophecy of the popes. And so I'm a publisher, so I'm always thinking about, you know, the types of things that should be published. And Joe started really encouraging me, you know, Dad, you're a publisher, you really ought to put together an outline and write something on this. And this is how preternatural all this began, and literally supernatural events begin clicking off one after the other. It's at that moment I go up to my hotel room because I'm waiting on my opportunity to speak. Somebody like Joel Richardson or somebody was up there speaking. And I went up to my hotel room to send myself an email with the note ideas that me and Joe had talked about the prophecy of the popes and why I should publish a book about it. And I open up my email account, and I have an email from a guy that I've never met before. And I've only ever even just barely heard. I knew he had a blog or something. I wasn't even sure about it. But I had an email from this guy named Chris Putnam. And he wanted to know if he could use the only paragraph that I had ever written. And I had written it all the way back in 2009, so 8 years ago. One paragraph, all I ever wrote, where I said, you know, the people with the year 2012 fascination, the Maya and all that, wouldn't it be interesting if the prophecy of the popes also kind of unrolled at this same time? But I got this email from Chris Putnam, and he wants to know, hey, Tom, my name's Chris Putnam. I'm in Bible college. I'm writing a term paper. Can I use the paragraph in my term paper that you wrote, whenever I wrote it? And I emailed him back, and I said, Chris, you can't believe the timing of your inquiry. I said, I was just now talking to my son about the prophecy of the Pope, which I haven't even thought about in years, and I was getting ready to produce an outline. Anyway, I don't want to give it to you blow by blow, but a long story short, a whole series of events put me and Chris Putnam together. We decided to write that book together. During our investigation, we had our own reasons why we came to believe that Pope Benedict XVI was going to step down. We published this. We're on TV talking about it. You can look up the YouTubes where a year before the event, we said we believe that Pope Benedict XVI is going to retire. He's going to cite health reasons for doing it to open the door for the arrival of the final pope and the final pope prophecies, Pope number 112. And furthermore, we went out on a limb. We said, we think this is going to happen in April of 2012. Well, when April of 2012 came and went, it didn't appear that the Benedict was going to retire. We thought, well, we missed the date, but we still think the book's valid. But then February 28th, 2013, Benedict announces his resignation as Pope, and that very same day, the news outlet for the Vatican, the El Observatore Romano, they gave an interview to the New York Times. You can still Google this and read it, in which they admitted that Pope Francis had secretly retired. April 2012, months earlier, he had done it privately after he returned from a trip in March of 2012. He had done it privately with the Curia, because if you recall, at that time was the whole Vatileaks scandal, where they were releasing different documents being stolen out of the Pope's office and all that. So they were very careful about it. And so we had got the month and the year correct. Now, it is true that Chris and I both had some Vatican, I wouldn't even say they're Vatican insiders. They were conservative cardinals, the two of them. Very conservative. These guys, by the way, do not like Pope Francis, I'll tell you that. They gave us a little bit of information, but a lot of the other part of it was just Hagman level, you know, get down in the dirt, investigation, go through thousands of pages of documentation, and we finally came up with that conclusion. Well, anyway, when we got that date right, man, my phone was ringing off the hook. We had people everywhere that was wanting us. We had people that even wanted us to go to Rome, but we were warned not to do it, so we didn't go to Rome. But the movie, The Final Pope, was made about it, just a whole lot of stuff, right, because we got that date correct. But here's the thing. I'm saying all that to say this. I want to bring it to the Unearthing the Lost World of the Cloud Eaters. And what put me on this path was, while Putnam then and I were out there doing all these programs, right, television, radio, and wherever there was opportunity for people to call in and ask questions, we were surprised that more often than not, they weren't asking us about the prophecy of the Pope. They were intrigued with that, but what they were asking us was, what do you make of the Vatican being out there now, talking so much about extraterrestrial intelligence and saying that they would baptize aliens? Do you remember that? Because it was around 2009 that the Vatican hosted this astrobiology study week. So around the same time that we're working on this book and we're out there talking, they had hosted this astrobiology study week. And it was really strange because they called together leaders from academia, geologists, nuclear physicists, quantum physicists. I don't even think they were using the term astrobiology in 2009, but that's what they would be today. People that study deep space with the question of, you know, the search for extraterrestrial intelligence study. They called all these people together from around the world, and they only had one question: come to Rome, because we want to discourse for a week of study on one question, and it was this. And people can Google this. I know it sounds fantastic, but it's true. The one question: what is the impact on faith and religion going to be given the disclosure or the discovery of advanced extraterrestrial intelligence? It was only 90 days later that the oldest scientific body in the world, the Royal Society, they come together. They, too, convene all these people from around the world, including theologians, and ask the very same question. This is a 350th year anniversary, the oldest scientific body on Earth. And you've got the queen, I forget what he's even called, but he's the astronomer royale. Got all these people there, and they're asking this question: what is the impact on faith going to be? So, you know, all around the world now, suddenly everybody's asking this question. They're calling into the shows Chris and I are doing. They're contacting the Vatican, and the Vatican so sends out these two primary astronomers for the church, Jose Gabriel Funes, who at that time was the head of the Vatican Observatory Research Group, and Guy Consolmagno, who was the Pope's personal astronomer and the keeper of their asteroid fragment collections, who today is the head of the Vatican Observatory Research Group. And for the last year, by the way, guess what? He's been on a tour going around the world. He wrote a book, and he's doing these big lectures at universities, and guess what the name of the lecture is? Would you baptize an alien? And so this whole conversation got out there, but here's what was weird about this. They started talking about would you baptize an alien, and Pope Benedict said he would. You notice that Pope Francis, as soon as he was elected, said that if the little green man land on the White House lawn tomorrow, he would baptize an alien. So they started talking about that kind of stuff. But then they started ratcheting it up. It started changing little by little. It's very subtle how they kind of introduce people to the idea and what's in philosophy, what's called the Fabian process of gradualism. They very slowly take people from one line of thinking, get you comfortable with it, then they take you to another line of thinking, or the Hegelian dialect. They take you to a different line of thinking until eventually you'll accept something that in the beginning you wouldn't even imagined you would have believed. So they're saying, yeah, I mean, we're just talking theoretically. The Vatican's had problems in the past persecuting scientists, so we want to get out ahead of all this and just say that with all these exo worlds that are being discovered, that if we detect alien intelligence, we would be willing to baptize them in the Catholic faith. Then, a few months later, they ratchet it up to a different place, and Jose Funes comes out and he gives this interview, and he says, now, people have asked, would the detection of extraterrestrial intelligence, would this challenge the authority of the Roman Catholic Church? And he said, no, it would not, because these would be our space brothers, because if they're part of creation, then the God that we serve created them. Then, a couple of months later, he ratchets it up a little further, and he says, not only would it not be against the faith to believe in extraterrestrial intelligence, but he said, the fact is, the heresy would be if you don't believe in extraterrestrial intelligence, because that would be to put limits on God's creative ability. And I know we're going to hit a break here in a minute, so let me just give you a couple more. They then ratcheted up, now the process of this 1 year, they ratcheted up even further, and they start saying, now, if we come into contact with the extraterrestrials, it might not be us baptizing them after all. Why? Because what we know about ourselves is that we are fallen. But we couldn't naturally assume necessarily that the aliens are fallen, and if they're unfallen, then they're closer to God than we are, and they have a better understanding of the Godhead and of the gospel and everything else. Then they ratcheted it up to a completely different place and even wrote a paper, an Opus Dei-level paper, that's still being evaluated in Rome, being considered as official doctrine for the Pope's university, in which they went so far as to say, when the aliens come here, we're not going to be baptizing them. They're going to be baptizing us into their faith. And frankly, we might have to rewrite, reconsider everything we've ever thought we knew. This is what they're working on right now. If they say if information from an extraterrestrial source would challenge what we think we know about the gospel, and if it could be verified, I don't know how you verify this, right? But if it can be verified as being legitimate, then we may have to rethink and rewrite everything we've ever thought we knew about the gospel. So when we come back from the break, I can tell you then how that kind of discussion led me and Chris Putnam to going to the top of Mount Graham, and how ultimately that led all of us, me, Steve, all of us, the Four Corners area, and the fantastic discoveries that we made there.
In Branson, I'm going to be covering the pre-Adamic angelic civilization, which all myths, legends, and all of the oral traditions speak about the Golden Age. Then I'm moving into Mars. Mars is really important because I'm dealing with astral catastrophism. Astral catastrophism is something that goes beyond Immanuel Velikovsky's Worlds in Collision. Most people can't even understand that the heavens, people on Earth were terrified by the cataclysms they had seen. The orbital physics that we now see when we see the picture of the universe aren't the same that existed 700 years before Jesus was born. And so, and by the way, I don't buy BCE and all that stuff, you know. I say before the birth of Jesus and after the resurrection of Jesus. I don't mean to be difficult, but I refuse to allow them to control the narrative. So what I'll be presenting, Tom, is I put together a pretty amazing, actually, J.D. Hopwood did the editing of this and stuff, but he followed my chapter that came right out of, guess where, Cloud Eaters. So Cloud Eaters, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, are the Native Americans' term for, and you guessed it, giants that are returning. So when people say to me, how did you get started, Genesis, the book of Genesis, so was opened up to me by the, I would say, the mercy of God. I was so stupid, Doug. I couldn't believe in anything when I first got saved until two people came and laid their hands on me from a Bible school saying God sent them. People can, you know, argue with that all the time. And they do argue with me. But look, I went from the guttermost to the uttermost with zero knowledge of anything to a passion to learn the Word of God and listen to all the great teachers of their day, of my day, in those days. I mean, these were guys that were, you know, just magnificent teachers of the Word of God. Derek Prince and Leonard Ravenhill and all the different people. And I mean, Bob Mumford, great sense of humor, Charles Simpson. Mm-hmm. I mean, the who's who that God was using to teach his people.
Yeah, I agree. In fact, what's interesting is that book was on my mind, too, because we have a whole chapter in there where we were saying, look, a lot of people are saying microchip technology is not going to be the technology that's going to be used for biometric identification, embedded chips, that is, for biometric identification. And we also talked about a lot of other ways in which people could be identified to fulfill the book of Revelation, that no man might buy or sell save he that hath the mark of the name of the beast or the number of the name. But, you know, even against what was kind of popular thinking at the time, we said we still think there could be a way that this is going to happen. And what are we seeing right now across the nation? You know, companies, businesses, people are being voluntarily microchipped, and now some of the banking industry talking about how this could be like the next wave and how buying and selling is going to happen. So, yeah, we're going to wait to see. But, you know, the last time I was on Hagman & Hagman, we talked about how the University of London, and I'm glad that Steve is going to be talking about this whole subject around transhumanism and connecting the dots between that and what we discovered in Unearthing the Lost World of the Cloud Eaters, the subject of transhumanism, because it's really the same sin being repeated again, where you have very powerful geneticists in the Old Testament. They're called watchers. They come down, they use the genetic makeup of women, combine that with animals, make these exotic bodies. That's how the giants arrived on the earth. So genetics is a key figure of this. But the University of London pigeonholing me and Steve Quayle in what they called the Melu. Remember we talked about that on the last program? And that they are saying that we are the leaders of the transhumanist resistance.
Yeah.
And so I got news for them. Yeah, I got news for him. After the first of the year, we're going to publish a book called The Melu, Welcome to the Resistance. And we're going to talk about all the reasons why we think there is good that will come out of biotechnology. I saw an article today on how nanotech destroyed cancer within something like 60 seconds. There could be some good things that come out of it. And Christians would not be opposed to good therapeutical uses of technology, but we also know that it's kind of a tricky little bioethics landmine, and that the good things are also going to be used to justify altering that God created in His image. But anyway, and I should also say, I always do something with the Hagmans that I don't do with anybody else. So anybody listening to this program tonight, if you want the in the SkywatchTVStore.com, SkywatchTVStore.com, there is the Unearthing the Lost World of the Cloud Eaters book and Steve Quayle's DVD. There's a combo in there for that. It's actually, we put the book and the DVD together and then actually reduced the price and then added a whole bunch of free stuff, free books and audio sets and all this stuff with it that we're giving away. And then you can also just get the book in there by itself. But if you do either one, if you want, if you don't have the book and you want it, or you want the DVD movie, go to SkywatchTVStore.com, and when you click on it to order it, on checkout, put in the promo code Hagman. We always do this with Hagmans. We don't do this with anybody else. We only do it with Hagman. Type in there Hagman in the promo code, and we're going to send you the last DVD ever produced by Chris Putnam, which is on the Vatican extraterrestrial connection. Fabulous DVD, very educational. We're going to give it to you, that too, for free, in addition to everything else. And then we're also going to give you the deluxe hardback copy of the Ancient Book of Enoch. You can't get this from anybody else but us. We're going to give that to you for free, too, if you go there and you buy either the combination of me and the book and the DVD, or even just buy the book by itself. But make sure you type in Hagman on checkout, and we're going to make sure that that gets sent to you. So it's a whole bunch of free stuff. If you want, if you're going to buy the book, you might as well get the free stuff.
Well, and are you turning it over to me now?
Yes, sir.
This is Steve.
Yes,
oh,
Steve.
Okay, I'm sorry, Doug. I didn't want to interrupt Tom. I think that one of the things that will be very useful to everyone is that there will probably be 12 to 14 hours of DVDs available. So for those of you that don't can't get to the conference, you're traveling, whatever, can't even go on live streaming, there's no limit to the amount of DVDs. Now, I've asked Gordon, the guy that's running this thing, McDonald, who, by the way, ran all of Chuck Missler's conferences for 20-plus years, to have these DVDs available almost ASAP, so the minute that, you know, we've got a master, they go out, and we're going to do our best to get these out immediately. Now, for those of you around the world, you know, you still got, there's still 330 spots of live streaming. My guess is by tomorrow that will be down to 280, and where this is going to be a different conference, this is a conference of impartation. Now, I don't go to conferences, and trust me, it was Tom's prodding, and in a good way, and others saying, you know, this might be something, you know, that you want to look at. And finally, I got peace, because as most people know, I don't do conferences. That's not saying whoopee, but it's just because, you know, usually there are too many speakers, and I don't believe that, you know, it serves a purpose when you get too many speakers. Now, saying that, the thing is that the focus on this is, I would say, history's jigsaw puzzle. Because unless you understand the root of evil, you can't deal with the fruit of evil. Unless you understand why aliens cannot be baptized, first and foremost, they're not creating the image and likeness of God. Unless you understand transhumanism is to do away with the very seed that God created when he brought forth Adam and Eve and all of their children. When he basically hid Noah and eight souls in the ark, they were the only pure genetic stock. And from this point on, Doug, I don't think people understand how critical it is. One of the things I was, Tom, this is what blew a lot of people's mind when I first started on talk radio 20-some years ago in KHNC, Johnstown, Colorado. I said, the entities, and I used that term then too, and they call them globalists, occultists, Satanists, whatever. The point is that they're literally, the scientific arm of them are literally out looking for some of the most evil men in history, because Jesus talks about, you know, the demons. When the demons go out of one person, they go walking in dark places looking for someone else. So imagine the reconstitution of the most villainous people on the planet, including Nimrod, including everybody that has been of legendary and evil fame. You can go to Hitler, you can go to Mao, Stalin, you name it. And imagine those evil spirits once again becoming reincarnated in in genetically modified bodies made out of the DNA. You probably know how well that went over 25 years ago, Tom. It didn't. But, Doug, one of the things that's the problem is this, and no man understands the calling of another man except they who have received the calling. You can see the fruit of the calling. You can look back. But at the end of a day, the guy that's called of God has to answer to God. And there's never going to be universal acceptance. I remember frustratingly seeking God on this, and he just dropped this into my spirit. No word of God spoken by a man of God is ever accepted by the people of God at the time it's given. And I'm being told, some of you might want to check it to see, but I'm being told that the Charisma News article pulled, somebody's trying to pull it up, and they said there's nothing there. I don't know if someone's listening in real time, but if you are, shame on you. Because again, you know, there was a difference in the Old Testament and prophets that wanted to speak nice and wonderful things to the people versus those who declared the will of God. And the ones that declared the will of God didn't end up basically having champagne dinners and caviar dreams, okay? But they ended up basically being put to death ultimately for their testimony. The two probably greatest prophets that is accepted or an exception would be Enoch and Elijah. And so when we're coming together, we are basically pieces of the puzzle. We're not the whole puzzle. But God is now starting to bring puzzle pieces together that most could not even seen the puzzle, let alone believe it was a puzzle that was being pieced together for the end time. Daniel talks about knowledge increasing and then being told by the angel, seal it up, Daniel, for the vision is yet for an appointed time, for knowledge shall run to and fro. Well, right now, it's almost impossible. Tom, you know this. Just keeping up with the transhumanist articles on a daily basis is almost an impossibility. So here's my dilemma, everyone. How do I take 45 years of stuff I've been writing about and then for the last 25 years broadcasting about, and how do I set that, and here's a word that I never thought would be coming out of my mouth, a linear and consistent fashion. Well, I got, like, for the record, I have, you know, my PowerPoint that's kind of, for me, the first time, but it's not going to be show and tell. It's going to be some pretty amazing stuff. Like I said, when you're dealing with the history of the world recorded, there's a reason why everybody was building solar observatories. There's a reason why everyone was worshiping the equinox. There's a reason why all this stuff is going on. And simply this, the ancients were terrified, absolutely terrified of the heavens and what their oral traditions. It was basically the Egyptian priest of Sais who said to Solon, Plato's grandfather, I think it was, that he said, when it comes to understanding the universe and understanding the catastrophic and cataclysmic events, you Greeks are but children. And again, so when we're talking about Adam and going forth from Adam, but when we're talking about the Table of Kings in the Sumerian time period, it's so hard for people to understand that in the scripture, God made it clear he didn't originally create the world without form and void, tohu and bohu, but they became that way due to the catastrophic and cataclysmic judgment on the earth of the angelic civilization. If you go to Obadiah, and it's only one chapter, and it says, though you set your nest amongst the stars, yet will I bring thee down. There was a planet called Rahab, and I'm going to be talking about this. Well, when you start talking about orbital physics, Bode's law, Roche's limit, the bottom line is you've got to show it visually so people can not only grasp it, but then you understand why when you're looking at some of the most ancient Sumerian stelae, when you're looking at the giants who are sitting on thrones and there's little people, they're not children, standing at their knees as these guys are seated, and you see all sorts of star charts, and even, by the way, all the cave paintings in, Lascaux, France, and some of these newer places, they're finding out they were monumental star charts. And some of the star charts are so advanced that there's no way Earth-dwelling You know, quote, cave dwellers could have known that. So where did they get that information? Tom and I both categorically reject the fact that somehow a paramecium had a date with a E. coli bacteria, and somehow they made it and produced human beings. Okay? But that's about as ridiculous as it gets. Because as Carl Sagan used to say, billions and billions of years. No, it isn't billions and billions of years. It's basically the catastrophic judgment of God on a pre-angelic civilization that was on Earth. And so we're talking about the times that were, the golden era, the times that people, you know, that we get little glimpses of, but we don't have a total understanding. The Word of God is true. There's nothing that's hidden that won't be revealed. And when you understand the wars that have taken place in heaven, the hatred for those who hate Jesus Christ, the absolute spiritual war that whether you want to be a participant in or not, you are in, the end times are unfolding before us, and, it, you know, again, I got to get over this, and I'm fixated right now on the mentality of Charisma Magazine, because charisma comes from that word charismata, or, you know, from which we get the word charismatic, and it means gifted. Well, it's talking about the gifts of the Holy Spirit, not I think, you think, we know. By the way, I'm a knight of the round table, a knight of Malta, a knight of this, a knight of that, and I want to say good night. You know, wake up, arise, for the light has come. You see, anything that's shrouded in secrecy and mystery is suspect, because they talk about ancient civilizations being, if you will, beneficiaries of the mystery religions. So as we're talking about all these events in Branson, I believe that there's going to come such a clarity and such an understanding, because it's only the Spirit of God that can give the spirit of wisdom and give the spirit of understanding. And obviously, the people of God have lacked it. And for those who believe that this thing can be won in the natural with an argument, good luck. The powers of darkness have stolen the narrative. You're seeing it in the incessant attack on the president. I'm just getting emails from some guy that's basically, he must have just stopped off on Earth from another planet, saying, it's all you people who voted for Trump that are bringing this on. And of course, he's the defender of the faith. So get beyond that. Get beyond and see something. God uses the technology of the wicked to destroy the wicked. Do I believe that everything you see in Houston and on the East Coast forming right now is man-made? Absolutely. Can God use it? Absolutely. Does God put it in their hearts, evil ones, to destroy themselves? Absolutely. So there is no conflict between the technology of those who seek to destroy mankind and God, who is above mankind, the creator of mankind, and rules over all devil kind, is in charge, and he is using their technology to make war, and so to make war on the saints. And Tom quoted it. See, here's the deal, Doug. If I could, I would ask, and I'm serious, Lord, that heaven would literally pour a bucket of ice water over everyone's heads, okay? And literally wake them up from the slumber. When you read about the mind control, neural mapping, all the stuff that DARPA is doing, Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, is doing to map the brain, to control the brain, to wipe away consciousness, to wipe away any good feelings, to take away humanity. That's the bottom line in all of it. You know, and the killer bots and the robots and the insane argument that even Elon Musk is making that, you know, AI is the end of us. And well, of course, but then they're using it and integrating in everything they do. And it's no loss, is it, that the majority of techno files and the heads of some of the biggest companies in the world. What blew a lot of people's mind when I first started on talk radio 20-some years ago in KHNC, Johnstown, Colorado, I said, the entities, and I use that term then too, and they call them globalists, occultists, Satanists, whatever. The point is that they're literally, the scientific arm of them are literally out looking for some of the most evil men in history, because Jesus talks about, you know, the demons. When the demons go out of one person, they go walking in dark places looking for someone else. So imagine the reconstitution of the most villainous people on the planet, including Nimrod, including everybody that has been of legendary and evil fame. You can go to Hitler, you can go to Mao, Stalin, you name it. And imagine those evil spirits once again becoming reincarnated in genetically modified bodies made out of the DNA. You probably know how well that went over 25 years ago, Tom. It didn't. But, Doug, one of the things that's the problem is this, and no man understands the calling of another man except they who have received the calling. You can see the fruit of the calling, you can look back, but at the end of a day, the guy that's called of God has to answer to God, and there's never going to be universal acceptance. I remember frustratingly seeking God on this, and he just dropped this into my spirit. No word of God spoken by a man of God is ever accepted by the people of God at the time it's given. And I'm being told, some of you might want to check it to see, but I'm being told that the Charisma News article pulled, somebody's trying to pull it up, and they said there's nothing there. I don't know if someone's listening in real time, but if you are, shame on you. Because again, you know, there was a difference in the Old Testament and prophets that wanted to speak nice and wonderful things to the people versus those who declared the will of God. And the ones that declared the will of God didn't end up basically having champagne dinners and caviar dreams, okay? But they ended up basically being put to death ultimately for their testimony. The two probably greatest prophets that is accepted or an exception would be Enoch and Elijah. And so when we're coming together, we are basically pieces of the puzzle. We're not the whole puzzle. But God is now starting to bring puzzle pieces together that most could not even seen the puzzle, let alone believe it was a puzzle that was being pieced together for the end time. Daniel talks about knowledge increasing and then being told by the angel, seal it up, Daniel, for the vision is yet for an appointed time, for knowledge shall run to and fro. Well, right now, it's almost impossible. Tom, you know this. Just keeping up with the transhumanist articles on a daily basis is almost an impossibility. So here's my dilemma, everyone. How do I take 45 years of stuff I've been writing about and then for the last 25 years broadcasting about, and how do I set that, and here's a word that I never thought would be coming out of my mouth, a linear and consistent fashion. Well, I got, like, for the record, I have, you know, my PowerPoint that's kind of, for me, the first time, but it's not going to be show and tell. It's going to be some pretty amazing stuff. Like I said, when you're dealing with the history of the world recorded, there's a reason why everybody was building solar observatories. There's a reason why everyone was worshiping the equinox. There's a reason why all this stuff is going on. And simply this, the ancients were terrified, absolutely terrified of the heavens and what their oral traditions. It was basically the Egyptian priest of Sais who said to Solon, Plato's grandfather, I think it was, that he said, when it comes to understanding the universe and understanding the catastrophic and cataclysmic events, you Greeks are but children. And again, so when we're talking about Adam and going forth from Adam, but when we're talking about the Table of Kings in the Sumerian time period, it's so hard for people to understand that in the scripture, God made it clear he didn't originally create the world without form and void, tohu and bohu, but they became that way due to the catastrophic and cataclysmic judgment on the earth of the angelic civilization. If you go to Obadiah, and it's only one chapter, and it says, though you set your nest amongst the stars, yet will I bring thee down. There was a planet called Rahab, and I'm going to be talking about this. Well, when you start talking about orbital physics, Bode's law, Roche's limit, the bottom line is you've got to show it visually so people can not only grasp it, but then you understand why when you're looking at some of the most ancient Sumerian stelae, when you're looking at the giants who are sitting on thrones and there's little people, they're not children, standing at their knees as these guys are seated, and you see all sorts of star charts, and even, by the way, all the cave paintings in you know, Lascaux, France, and some of those newer places, they're finding out they were monumental star charts. And some of the star charts are so advanced that there's no way Earth-dwelling, you know, quote, cave dwellers could have known that. So where did they get that information? Tom and I both categorically reject the fact that somehow a paramecium had a date with a E. coli bacteria, and somehow they made it and produced human beings. Okay? But that's about as ridiculous as it gets. Because as Carl Sagan used to say, billions and billions of years. No, it isn't billions and billions of years. It's basically the catastrophic judgment of God on a pre-angelic civilization that was on Earth. And so we're talking about the times that were, the golden era, the times that people, you know, that we get little glimpses of, but we don't have a total understanding. The Word of God is true. There's nothing that's hidden that won't be revealed. And when you understand the wars that have taken place in heaven, the hatred for those who hate Jesus Christ, the absolute spiritual war that whether you want to be a participant in or not, you are in, the end times are unfolding before us, and, it, you know, again, I got to get over this, and I'm fixated right now on the mentality of Charisma Magazine, because charisma comes from that word charismata, or, you know, from which we get the word charismatic, and it means gifted. Well, it's talking about the gifts of the Holy Spirit, not I think, you think, we know. By the way, I'm a knight of the round table, a knight of Malta, a knight of this, a knight of that, and I want to say good night. You know, wake up, arise, for the light has come. You see, anything that's shrouded in secrecy and mystery is suspect, because they talk about ancient civilizations being, if you will, beneficiaries of the mystery religions. So as we're talking about all these events in Branson, I believe that there's going to come such a clarity and such an understanding, because it's only the Spirit of God that can give the spirit of wisdom and give the spirit of understanding. And obviously, the people of God have lacked it. And for those who believe that this thing can be won in the natural with an argument, good luck. The powers of darkness have stolen the narrative. You're seeing it in the incessant attack on the president. I'm just getting emails from some guy that's basically, he must have just stopped off on. Beyond that, get beyond and see something. God uses the technology of the wicked to destroy the wicked. Do I believe that everything you see in Houston and on the East Coast forming right now is man-made? Absolutely. Can God use it? Absolutely. Does God put it in their hearts, evil ones, to destroy themselves? Absolutely. So there is no conflict between the technology of those who seek to destroy mankind and God, who is above mankind, the creator of mankind, and rules over all devil kind, is in charge, and he is using their technology to make war, and so to make war on the saints. And Tom quoted it. See, here's the deal, Doug. If I could, I would ask, and I'm serious, Lord, that heaven would literally pour a bucket of ice water over everyone's heads, okay? And literally wake them up from the slumber. When you read about the mind control, neural mapping, all the stuff that DARPA is doing, Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, is doing to map the brain, to control the brain, to wipe away consciousness, to wipe away any good feelings, to take away humanity. That's the bottom line in all of it. You know, and the killer bots and the robots and the insane argument that even Elon Musk is making that, you know, AI is the end of us. And well, of course, but then they're using it and integrating in everything they do. And it's no loss, is it, that the majority of techno files and the heads of some of the biggest companies in the world, technology companies, are at the Burning Man. Does anybody want to guess who the Burning Man is? And it's not just going back to the Druid worship of the Wicker Man. It goes way beyond that, because basically, I'll make it easy for you. Out of the flames of hell, the devil will come forth. He will come forth in fury. He will make war on the saints. And they that know their God shall be strong and do victory. So, you know, and so have victory. So the point is, and they that know their God shall be strong. And what does the rest of the scripture say, Tom?
and do exploits.
Yeah, do exploits. What is an exploit? Thank you, sir. My mouth is going, can't keep up with my brain. The exploits are that which is accomplished through the power of the Holy Ghost beyond everything. Now, look, God gave good gifts to men. You can quote the Ephesians 6 chapter of We Wrestle Not Against Flesh and Blood. You can quote the spiritual warfare. You can say you understand this stuff, but the bottom line is if you don't integrate it and overcome it, what good does it do?
Go ahead, Tom. Amen. You're right. You're right. Go ahead. Yeah. Go ahead, Tom.
Every damn night.
I don't know how many shows, Steve, have we done where the whole program is based around talking about the layout of Washington, D.C. 44 signers of the Declaration of Independence being devotees of Francis Bacon's New Atlantis when the gods are going to reunite with humanity. Talk about transhumanism, by the way. If you read the prophecy of the Kume Sibyl, she talks about this final empire as a moment when the gods will once again be commingled with man. Well, that's absolutely the story of the Watchers that came down and commingled with humanity, and they wanted to build a city. People should go to the Library of Congress. Read the article in the Library of Congress called The Most Approved Plan, in which George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, all these people, they got together. They advertised a contest on the layout of Washington, D.C., and they advertised to all these different engineers and said, whoever comes up with the best plan is going to win the contest, and we're going to design the capital city. So all these plans by engineers, famous people, by the way, designers across the U.S., come up with all these plans. But read the article on our own Library of Congress website where it says that Washington and Thomas Jefferson rejected all of the plans. Why? It says this on the website. It says because they wanted a city based on the old Roman pantheon and dedicated to all pagan gods. That's what the Library of Congress, U.S. Library of Congress website says. So that's what they wanted. That's what they built. That's why you have a dome facing an obelisk based on this ancient Egyptian ritualism that would bring about the raising of Osiris from the underworld. And again, like I say, we've done whole shows on this. We've got whole books on this. I don't need to go back through all of that. But that's what they are looking for now. But what would people say? But by the way, I went to the House of the Temple. I had a congressman that put this together for me. I had a private meeting. Nita Horn went with me. My wife went with me so that I could verify this after the fact, and I'm glad I took her with me, although it scared the thunder out of her. We had a private meeting with two 33rd degree Freemasons at the House of the Temple, and I asked them a whole bunch of questions. They answered all my questions until I asked them this one question. Is it true? I've been told that at the inauguration of every American president, right here at the House of the Temple, just a little ways, 16th Street, just a little ways from the White House, while they're over there and the president is standing in the ever-present belly, pregnant belly of ISIS, the U.S. Capitol Dome, and if you look up, you see Washington, the apotheosis of Washington, becoming a god, and all of the entities around him are non-Christian. They're all pagan and demonic. And then below that, a 72 pentagrams for controlling the 72 cosmocrators that control the earth. The president stands below that while he's facing the obelisk across the Washington Mall. While he's doing this ancient Egyptian position across town, you have the modern Egyptians, magicians that are standing inside the House of the Temple, inside this holy room. I went into the holy room. I looked at the altar. I looked up above it at the magic 666 square that was used in antiquity for the raising of Apollo, or as the Greeks or as the Egyptians would have called him, Osiris. And I looked at the big throne of the Grand Poobah, and where all the 33rd degree Freemasons sat. And I said, is it true that at the inauguration of every president, that you conduct the raising of Osiris ceremony while he's standing over there like an ancient Egyptian pharaoh looking at the obelisk for the purpose of simulating what ultimately is going to happen, and that is a leader of the United States of America is going to become the fulfillment of this ancient pagan prophecy that Roosevelt and Henry Wallace wrote about in all their works and why they put the Great Seal on the United States, and the Antichrist, as he is otherwise known in the Bible. is going to assume his rule over the United States of America. Do you actually do that? And these guys both got quiet. They wouldn't answer my question. One of the guys got up, walked out of the room. Nita looked at me and drew her fingers across her throat, right? Like, shut up, boy, and don't say another word. And a few minutes later, the other guy came back. He wants to give me these two coins that have these very strange symbols on them. One of them almost looks a little bit like the Statue of Liberty. The other side has an uncapped pyramid, kind of like the Great Seal of the United States. And I don't want to take them because I don't know what they are. And he keeps saying, yeah, you should take these, you should take these. So I took them with me and threw them into the dash of my car. They later burned up in my house when, and you all know that story, the house 2011 burned down. And I called a friend of mine who was an ex-Freemason, and I said, what was that all about? And he said, oh, Tom, he said, that's old school, man. He said, that's like back in the day when they would say, you know, do you have something for the widow's son? Basically, they were giving you a pass. Otherwise, you could have been killed for the questions that you were asking. You were getting too close to the bottom line. But now the Freemasons, they want to open up. They want to make this sexy. They want to make it appeal to today's modern generation. So they're letting some of their most highly concealed secrets out. Well, that was then. Fast forward to today. And look at what highly placed Washington insiders were doing that were revealed to us now in the WikiLeaks with the raising rituals and the spirit cooking between people that were all around Hillary Clinton. John Podesta, talking about contiguous aliens. There you go again, right, Steve? Contiguous aliens, aliens all around us. They were saying 2017 is going to be the year of official disclosure. Elect Hillary. She's out there on late night television saying, if you elect me, I'm going to make sure that we uncover this whole thing about aliens. The bottom line is, everything you see there, I'll do this real quick because I know we'll run out of time. Everything you see in those WikiLeaks, and I go into a lot of the history in the upcoming book, Saboteurs, this all dates back to the Jet Propulsion Laboratory founder, Jack Parsons, the Scientology founder, L. Ron Hubbard, and their Babylon Working. Now, what did they do? In the Babylon Working, 1946, the Babylon Working, they conduct a whole series of sex magic rituals based on Aleister Crowley's Telema and his OTO. They're devotees of Aleister Crowley. The whole purpose of this was to bring through a dimensional vortex, a gate, in other words, like the Bible talks about, into our reality, the incarnation of the whore of Babylon, the archetype divine feminine. Now, if you read Jack Parsons' biography that he was working on before he blew himself up in a rocket experiment and died, in his biography, he makes a celebratory statement that in 1946 they were successful and that a female child was conceived in a woman somewhere in the United States. He doesn't say where, right? Now, if you follow the logic forward, 9 months later, 1947, a female child should have been born. He says she will be an internationally known feminist, but she will also take the helms of political power and be a global leader. The only woman born in 1947 that meets that criterion was Hillary Clinton. What I'm telling you is when you read the WikiLeaks, it is very, very obvious that these people around Hillary Clinton, John Podesta, Tony Podesta, all these other people, Marina Abramovic, they all believe that she is incarnation of the Babylon Working because she was born in the right year. But here's one more thing I want you guys to think about, and I bet you didn't know this. 1 year after Hillary Clinton was born, so now we're talking about 1948, guess what happened? Jack Parsons, before he blows himself up, he writes a booklet, a small book, called The Book of the Antichrist. And guess what he said in this book? He said this: the child had been born, she's 1 year old now, and he said her spirit comes to him and tells him that she is going to help the Antichrist come to power. So she's not the Antichrist, but she's going to help the Antichrist come to power. But here's where it gets weird. She even told him her name. She told him, my name is Hilarion, which is the arcane Hillary. Now, I would like a mathematician somewhere to tell me, what other woman on earth named Hillary was born in 1947 that is an internationally known feminist that has the potential to become the leader of the most powerful nation on earth? And then it gets even weirder, because in 2020, at the next election, she'll be 72. And by the way, Donald Trump just proved that being 70 does not disqualify you from becoming the president of the United States of America. And every occultist everywhere knows the value of the number 72. It's the most powerful number in arcane occultism. So there are some very strange things going on. Now, I'm not saying that Hillary is the incarnation of the Babylon working, but I'm telling you that there is no doubt whatsoever that the people who were around her in the lead-up of the last election absolutely did believe that she was, because they were practicing the same occultism of Aleister Crowley, Jack Parsons, and L. Ron Hubbard, and even talking about the same aliens that L. Ron Hubbard based his Church of Scientology on. So there is some very powerful people in Washington, D.C. today, and we haven't even got into the whole thing about Pizzagate. Pizzagate, everybody thinks Pizzagate is over. I think that we just brushed it aside. Everybody from, you know, some of our friends who stepped aside because of pressure or the threat of a lawsuit or whatever, they let that go. But I think there was definitely something that was there and that was operating. But anyway, so that's why I'm in October, I'm putting out this book, Saboteur, Shadow Government in Quest of the Final World Order. I'm going to give people a money-back guarantee. In fact, we're going to sell it by the case, because I can tell you, people are going to buy this by the case. They're going to give it to everybody they know. It's the most important thing I ever wrote. But I am going to put a warning, that because there are things that I can't say on a family-friendly radio show like the Hagman. Some of what was going on, some of what is going on, it is some nasty, terrible, scary, spooky crap. But I'm going to publish it. It was in one of the WikiLeaks files. It's one of the images that he emailed with the number 14 on his right hand and a fish on his left hand. And everybody was saying, what in the world does this mean? Well, anybody that knows the story of Osiris knows exactly what this means. I mean, Osiris chopped into 14 pieces. That's the number on his left hand. And the fish ate the 14th part, his male phallus, which is iconified in the great Washington Monument in Washington, D.C., but also in the obelisk that stands in St. Peter's Square. This is all well known. It's not mysterious. It's not difficult to understand. This is necromantic worship for the express purpose of bringing about the resurrection of the spirit of Osiris to fulfill the prophecy that is on the Great Seal of the United States, to bring about the incarnation of the Antichrist. Now, so what I think is this, by the way, I think that going into 2020, you might wind up with a male figure who could be the president of the United States of America, who has as his VP, Hillary. And if that happens, let me tell you, that is...
It's a big club, and you ain't in it. You and I are not in the big club. By the way, it's the same big club they used to beat you over the head with all day long when they tell you what to believe.
What we see in the WikiLeaks revelation.
When Tom is talking about number 72, and I'm not going into this very far just because, you know, I don't want, you know, people going here, and I'll just give you the long and short of it. The number 72, there are 72 ionospheric heaters, like HARP, okay, around the world. There are 72 demon gates, which are called the Goetic gates, G-O-E-T-I-C gates. And so what you've got is you've got the number 72, which is mystical, and you've also got the issue now that is becoming, does it not seem strange to people that sex was the thing that drew the angels out of heaven as they looked on earth women? Jude talks about the angels not keeping their first estate. Those original angels that did that, that descended on Mount Hermon, they basically injected or introduced their, if you will, fallen nature now, and they were able to take on the form of men and the size accordingly to produce the giants, the mighty men of old. But now you go forward and you go to the Vatican and you go to all the nonsense about the aliens. If you studied the UFOs for years, and I've done it, Tom's done it, abductions, you always end up back at the same thing in the book of Genesis, Genesis chapter 6. Or you end up in the book of Jude. And here is the issue that I want to clear up for everybody. If you don't think that the law of first mention, meaning the first time it appears in the Old Testament, is relevant, then you might as well basically, seriously, go become something other than a Christian. Because the Bible teaches specifically that Jesus said that basically he came to destroy the works of the evil one. And Jesus warned us about being not deceived. The deception is so great. So now we've got the whole alien phenomenon, and, you know, whether you believe in the black-eyed children or all the offspring or anything, the point is you've got this in your face, if you will, perverted sexuality. And you've got it with the fallen angels. You've got it with their giant offspring. You've got it with the, if you will, the embodiment through genetic engineering, the reconstitution of these things. And by the way, I was told by somebody, he said, you know, not only do these guys have appetite for human flesh, the giants that have come out of stasis, but they also have the appetite for the same thing that drew them to the earth. And I'll just leave it at that. Women. So, you know, the idea is simply this. You have, in ritual magic, you have to have sex. You have to have that creative reproduction reproductive, procreative element involved in it. Because what they're saying every time they do that is that they're going to reintroduce all of their fallen offspring, because the fallen angels beg God not to kill their children, and that's where the word bastards come from. And so, you know, I'm sorry, but I'm going to go here with this statement. I do not believe that most of the people that we see in the Congress and Senate are still human beings in the classic sense of the word. I believe that they have given themselves over to a Luciferic initiation, and that is the only way to explain the Republican Democrats intentionally destroying this country to bring about the Great One. Even Mitch McConnell was on record as saying he had a spiritual experience. No one was even astute enough to say, yeah, but what's the source of your experience? You see, so this is why modern Christendom will accept everything except the truth. They will persecute the truth, and the modern Christendom, who are reprobate, will demand the state that they go and take us out. And Tom, my formula now is playing out, and I didn't originate this. I, India, Victor, November, Delta, identify, vilify, nullify, destroy. And so you're seeing this in every single aspect of the outreach. Why is it that all of the, if you will, the different demonic manifestations on Earth now are being seen, being recorded, being videotaped, being iPhoneated. And the thing that's impossible for most people to get through their mind is, well, they're playing, fiddling. It's not, well, fiddling while Rome burns. It's fiddling while Lucifer ascends. It's fiddling while basically the whole realm of creation will soon be on Earth battling in the quintessential battle of the ages. And so, you know, when people are sending me emails, oh, Brother Quayle, aren't you so happy that the ashes of the red heifer have been found? I say, absolutely not. Do you know who comes into that temple? The Antichrist. That's what fulfills biblical prophecy. And so, the bottom line is, Jesus said, I came, you received me not, but another will come claiming to be me, Jesus speaking, and him you will receive. So I got to tell you something, Tom. I see this thing absolutely escalating beyond anything now that we even have to reference it by. That's why I believe men's hearts will fail them, because they will lose a context for their understanding if they shun what you and I and Derek and L.A. and Dr. Michael, you know, are trying to teach us, you know. And again, that they have been. These guys have been raised up and given Dr. Michael Lake. And so we're at this point now where it's critical. And I believe that Branson, let me just say one more thing about Branson. Branson is a time sensitive conference unlike any other, because I do not believe that so much, research and so much all of the ends coming together from various areas of the world. It didn't happen 10 years ago. It didn't happen 20 years ago. It happened in the last couple of years, and that's because God is going to present a cohesive picture of history, and whether people accept it or reject it, that's their responsibility before God. But our responsibility before God is to pass on to those who have willing hearts, open ears, and eyes to see. And that's what we're doing this for. So, ladies and gentlemen, again, there's only 330, I think, spots available for live streaming, and the DVDs will be available as quickly as we can literally get the masters off. And since this thing's over on Sunday, that means they go out on Monday, and we're going to try and get them in your hands within no later than 2 weeks. So, you know, I'm excited, Tom. Obviously, our roundtable will be probably one of the most interesting roundtables. Derek will be mediating that, and he knows how to ask the right questions. And I think that people ought to really get it together, because, as you say, in the occultists in Washington, D.C. are conducting rituals to literally open the gates. And Native Americans are saying, we got it done already, boys. But they don't. They know what happens when the gates open. Go ahead.
Potatoes, precious. What's potatoes, huh?
Potatoes. Boil them, mash them, stick them in a stew.
Went everywhere with, and these, and people need to know this, because we'll have to talk about all this at the conference, given the fact we're going to run out of time here in a minute. But the people that we met with in the Four Corners area, these were not Johnny Come Latelys. Through our mutual friend Michael Herring, who was many, many years a museum curator for the American Indian, a senior lecturer at the Smithsonian Institute, and we still may have an opportunity to interview some of the people at the Smithsonian on what, you know, we have called in our book, Unearthing the Lost World of the Cloud Eaters, the Great Smithsonian Cover-Up, why the bones were acclimated. And we're not even going to have time tonight to get into the fact that why would they collect all these bones? Well, the superficial answer, of course, the Powell Doctrine, is that anything that would fly in the face of Darwinian evolution, that we were all were an amoeba that crawled up out of a swamp and became, you know, something, and finally we stood up like that little, whatever that little green lizard thing is that sells insurance, we finally stood up, you know, and became that. Eventually a monkey and a whatever. Anything that flies in the face of Darwinian evolution had to be shut down according to the Powell Doctrine. Well, of course, giants. And we didn't, I'm going to show, by the way, some of the Smithsonian's own records. I've got records, and New York Times 1980s and 1800 and 1900 records from the Smithsonian showing where they recovered the bones of giants that were 11, 12 feet tall and even higher. And these are in their executive reports. Well, that's bigger than what most people believe Goliath in the New Testament was, which many people put at 9 feet, others put at 18. But the whole point is, what were they doing spiriting away? And Bind Deloria, who is an academic and an attorney in the among the Native Americans, said that there's a Indiana Jones-like building where they're hiding these bones. Well, why are they doing that? Well, the answer is only partly that it was because it flies in the face of Darwinian evolution. The other answer is what we learned from the senior leaders from among the Zuni and Hopi tribes, which was, this was unprecedented, because Hopi don't sit down with anybody. And yet we got the leaders of their tribes. We got people that were the representatives to the U.S. government for tribal affairs. I mean, we got top-level people. that are part of the Unearthing the Lost World of the Cloud Eaters book and also your documentary film, that sat down privately, secretly with me, you, and both of our teams for a week late last year. We learned from them there's another reason why they collected all their bones, and it is occultism, that those bones, according to them, have a kind of magical, metaphysical property to them that has to do with the Raphaim of the Old Testament scripture that talks about those bones, those dead giants squirming beneath the surface of the earth, and Isaiah praying that God would not allow those giants to rise from the dead, that they have a rejuvenating kind of mystical property. Timothy Alberino and you ran into that when you were in Peru, that the children go out and they lay on the top of these giant grave sites. Why? Because they acclimate the energies of these gods. So there is a great deal of mysticism around this, but it does also seem to be supported by scripture. And we're going to get into all of that, what we learned, and probably some of these deeper secrets. Doug, I'm really sorry that we ran out of time tonight, because I definitely wanted to ask you about Pizzagate. Why? Because as we're talking about occultists, the number 72, and Derek Gilbert wrote a whole book, the Great Inception, which goes into this whole thing about 72. Why did Jesus send out 72 disciples? Because Jesus came to fulfill what the Hebrews of his time expected in the Messiah, to overturn the curse that the watchers had brought upon the earth. So very fascinating stuff. We're going to be getting into all of that at this conference, and it's actually going to revolutionize people's understanding of the gospel. So they need to get the live streaming or to get the DVDs after the fact, since evidently the whole thing is sold out. If people go to skywatchtvstore.com tonight, they order either the book by itself, Unearthing the Lost World of the Cloud Eaters, or the combination deal that has Steve's new Gen 6 documentary film and the book. There's a whole ton of stuff over there they're already giving away free. But if you type in the promo code Hagman on checkout, we're also going to give you Chris Putnam's DVD on his last DVD, his last thing he made before he died, the Vatican Extraterrestrial Connection, as well as the book that so much of our research is actually based on, right? The Ancient Book of Enoch. But in this case, it's the collector's hardback deluxe version of that book. It's only available from us, and we're going to give it to you for nothing if you take advantage of that tonight. But, hey, the next program we do, I really, Joe and Doug, I want to ask you some questions, because when you're talking about Crowley occultism, as you know, Aleister Crowley said, when you're doing this magic and you're bringing up the supernaturalism from this other dimension, nothing is more important than the blood of the innocent, the blood of the pedophilic victim. That's where these other parts of what was going on in the revelations and in these WikiLeaks, where it ties to Pizzagate. You got people like Hastert, who went to prison. The judge that sentenced him to prison, he's already out, but the judge that sent him to prison called him a predator.
One thing I would like to say for those who are going to be attending the conference, or those who will be live streaming, or those who will be getting the DVDs, I would strongly encourage you to go, on my website, stevequayle.com, and get the True Legends package. And True Legends package, the name of the True Legends series started because of the book on True Legends. Because in the first couple chapters, I lay out the reason for the cover-up. I lay out the fact that the specific presidents of the United States believed in what we're talking about. And the thing is that if they read the book, we got a special on the book and on the, three DVDs together. I think it's $79. But here's the point. If they don't have that, or if they've already gotten the book, they can go on Vimeo, V-I-M-E-O, and download any place in the world, for those who are listening, download The Holocaust of Giants or The Unholy See. And when you understand what we mean by Unholy See, the Holy See is called the Pope, the Unholy See, which is, by the way, moving at breakneck speed to prove that he is a false prophet, in my opinion. To Catholics, he's known as the Anti-Pope. And Technology of the Fallen was number one. So all of these pieces pieces are coming together. And the greatest puzzles of all time have been sealed up until the time of the end. And here's what I'm excited about. Doug, you know, Joe and Tom, this is part of the unsealing that Daniel was told to seal up. Because I can speak from personal experience, when God shows you the history of the world in a future sense, and then he takes it from you and says, I'm only going to release you to know what's going on right before it comes to pass, I can literally identify with that. That's what happened to me when I was in the presence of Jesus, face to face. People fight me on that and say, oh, you're making it up. And I fight me on that and go, God, why am I so not doing the miracles of the living God? And why are my friends dying when you said we'll do greater things than these? And, you know, I have issues with that. And somebody once said, we explain the scripture, and it's real simple. With much knowledge comes much sorrow. But I'd add to that, not adding to the word of God, but I would add to the concept by making a statement and ridicule. And again, even Sir Isaac Newton, who David Flynn probably had the greatest understanding of, Sidonia, the Secret Chronicle of Mars, I'm going to be dealing at Branson with what I call the Marzetta Stone. And because we have a brother in South Africa, God bless you, Sean, that basically, did some incredible work on the Martian Morse code, tying it in with the geoglyphs at Tiwanaku that David Flynn proposed was a language. We got some mind-breaking stuff, and I promise you this, that, you know, once it comes out, then Tom will have, you know, I hope he doesn't have 140,000 Tom Horn wannabes, but if people understood how much we get ripped off and get a million views, and that
you said it, man. Nobody fucks with the Jesus.